Good afternoon. It is my pleasure to welcome you back for our last panel session. So as you know, I introduced the afternoon as focusing on the role of computing technologies to things that we consider very near, dear, and personal. And in the past panel, we had terrific discussions around learning, education, and labor. With this panel, we're going to draw closer to another set of issues that we are frequently concerned with, whether it's taking care of ourselves, our family, our community, and that is health, and in particular, health, aging, and disability, and the relationship amongst the three. I'm going to introduce to you in a few minutes our terrific panel, but I'm very excited about the expertise and passion and commitment that our panelists have embraced throughout their career. So I know that you're going to learn a lot from their remarks in our subsequent discussion. I don't have pretty slides like last time, but I do have a few just to get us going. Chuck, Charles, this is for you. So in one slide, as many statistics as I could get about the current U.S. healthcare system, whether we look at this in terms of absolute or relative expenditures, the potential for improving efficiency within the system, or at least lowering the harm the system causes through death or through injury, the increasing complexity of the system in terms of the number of activities engaged with the system or the number of patients a physician would have to see or a number of physicians that a patient has to see at this particular time. And then just even the notion of the fact that even if we're working from the best science, the best knowledge that we have, that only half of people actually get the recommended care that would normally be prescribed or following from the literature itself, or just even if we could reduce the deaths by removing disparities in access to care and the quality of care delivered. Like many things perhaps in our previous discussion, we have a lot of room for growth and improvement within the system, and computing technologies has a profound role to play in this. But then moving on, as we also look at the major participants in the healthcare system. So in my other life, when I'm not here doing this, I work in pediatric care, and we could have a separate conversation about the role and importance of healthcare in terms of pediatrics. But today we're going to focus on a part of that system that I think everyone in this room cares about deeply, which is the role of healthcare and, in general, our experience as we age. And one of the resources that you have available to you at the registration desk, as well as on our side and the others on the PCAS side, is the recent report to the president by PCAS on independence technology and connection in older age. And that's one of the reports in one of the series that all three of the individuals here either had an explicit role or an implicit role in terms of the material that's contained in this report. But one of the aspects, so I think many people have seen charts akin to this, whether it's within the U.S. population, Europe, Japanese, Asian populations, which is increasing growth in an aging population. But even during the tenure of the time period that I have been working in the realm of technologies for aging in place, has been our understanding of what aging actually looks like. So when I started working in this field, there was this notion of healthy aging, and healthy aging was one that was relatively free of disease and disability. And I know some of what you're going to hear from Margaret and from others is that we have learned to disavow ourselves of this perfect model of aging, but that we actually understand that disease and disability is now part of that natural state of affairs, whether we want it to be or not, and it's something that our system must be able to acknowledge as well. So today's conversation is going to focus on, again, yet another complex adaptive system where computing technology plays a role, a central role, but it's not a singular role in terms of looking at how we take care of ourselves in terms of healthcare, and how do we do that in the context of the changing requirements by our bodies and by our environments and by our society. And extra points for the panelists if you figure out also how to keep people gainfully employed in relationship to the previous panel. So with that, I'm thrilled to introduce our panelists and give you a little bit more context for our discussions. So to start, Margaret Campbell is playing both herself and Chris Castle. Chris, as you, if you're looking at the bios, you're wondering about this last-minute performance switch. Chris Castle was one of the main organizers and editors of this particular report. CCC had the privilege of working with her and others and with Margaret on a workshop that we held a year and a half ago around technologies and the role of aging in place. And then we were very excited on the CCC to see many of those recommendations and observations then incorporated into the PCAST report. Chris is grounded in California due to logistics associated with her moving there. And so Margaret gets many merit award points by being willing to step into the speaking role as of Friday evening. So I'm really excited about her participation, and I can certainly vouch for her credentials and excited about her speaking to you. She, I won't go through her entire career. She is recently retired, but the last time I interacted with her, she was serving as the senior scientist for planning and policy support within the National Institute on Disability, Independent Living, and Rehabilitation Research, I think fondly known as NIDLR. NIDLR had been recently moved into the Administration for Community Living in the Department of Health and Human Services. And I've had the privilege of interacting with her based on some of the RERC centers based at Georgia Tech as well. So Margaret is going to be followed by Charles, a.k.a. Chuck Friedman. And he is the Josiah Macy Jr. Professor of Medical Education and Chair of the Department of Learning Health Sciences at the University of Michigan Medical School. So not surprisingly, he's going to be talking to us about learning health sciences and learning health systems. But he is no stranger to Washington. Prior to coming to the University of Michigan, he held multiple executive appointments at the Office of the National Coordinator for Health, IT, known as ONC to all of us, within Health and Human Services. He was the Deputy National Coordinator from 2007-2009, and then rose to the ONC's Chief Scientific Officer from 2009 to 2011. He was the lead author on the first National Health IT Strategic Plan that was released in June 2008, and has led many of the discussions between EU and US cooperation in the understanding of e-health. I don't know if that means he's taking all questions on Obamacare, but I know he had quite a bit to do with the tremendous amount of investment that the federal government has made around health IT interoperability and EHR systems. And then last but certainly not least is Rory Cooper. I had the pleasure of getting to know Rory better through the development of the PCAST report. He is a distinguished professor of the Department of Rehabilitation Science and Technology and professor of bioengineering and mechanical engineering at the University of Pittsburgh. There he is the founding director as well as a VA senior research career scientist at the VA Rehabilitation Research and Development Center of Excellence there. He's also a U.S. Army veteran and the director of the Paralyzed Veterans of America Research Foundation, and continues also as a member of the U.S. Secretary of Veterans Affairs Prosthetics and Special Disability Programs Advisory Committee. And one of the things that I learned in the context of preparing for today's session is that he's not only working within the U.S. context, but he's also been actively collaborating with the Indian Spinal Cord Center in Delhi on improving access to quality services and devices for people with disabilities in India and throughout developing countries. And in fact, one of the issues that we talked about with respect to the PCAST report was even the differences between what is available to veterans within our U.S. system versus what is available or not available to people who are outside that system, and I think he will speak to those policy issues as well. So I'm very excited. We're going to have the same format, brief presentations, and then general and open discussion with the audience. And with that, I will turn it over to Margaret. Thank you.
Greetings to everybody. Good afternoon. I am very honored to be a pinch hitter for Chris Castle, I have a disclaimer. I understand there was one earlier today. I am not a computer scientist. I am a social scientist, so a sociologist specifically. So I come to this whole issue from a very different perspective. So without any further ado, and I really was honored to be invited, and I had very little time because while Chris Castle recently moved from here to California, I'm in the process of packing, literally, to move from here to the state of Washington. So this is in between packing. So my title, I'm trying to do multiple things here because I want to obviously deliver Chris's slides and do justice to her slides, but also put them in a different, a broader context. So my title, which is long, is Adopting an Aging and Disability Perspective to Identify National Computing Research Priorities, Implications for Learning Health Systems, and Recommendations from the PCAST Report on Technology. So that's my title. Next slide, please. Oh, do I advance them? Okay. Well, what did I not press? What am I not? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, thank you. So three objectives. The first then is to communicate Chris Castle's slides in the context of the recent PCAST report on independence, technology, and connection in older age. And then part two, to illustrate the intersection of aging and disability, of the aging and disability experience. What are the intersections? And highlight the shared needs and opportunities for technology-based interventions and services. And then part three, describe the key priorities of serving older adults and persons with disabilities. And the three I'm going to highlight are accessibility, usability, and person-centered planning, and the implications for the for learning health system concept and for shaping an inclusive computer research agenda that is responsive to the needs of both target populations. So that's what I'm going to do, starting with part one, Chris Castle's slides. Her title was Systems Engineering, Complexity, and Personalization are Key to Good Geriatric Care. So she shows a slide we're all familiar with, or many of us are familiar with. And I think the important things to point out here are that right now in 2016, as I said in my question, there are about 44.7 million persons 65 years of age and older. But by 2060, that will double to almost 100 million people 65 and over. So expanding group, and you see the breakdown by what used to be called the young old, the 65 to 74. So if you're in the room and you're in that, the young old, remember Bernice Baumgartner, who came up with these distinctions, the old and then the oldest old. But of course, 85 and over is no longer the oldest old. It's the 100 and over, right? So the characteristics of the aging population that Chris identified are these five. I highlighted some in red because they apply to both older adults as well as people with disabilities. And of course, I could have done heterogeneous too, obviously. So the aging population is definitely heterogeneous by race and ethnicity, by geographic location, by health status, by socioeconomic status, and many other markers of heterogeneity. They are high risk of experiencing multiple conditions as well as multiple impairments, visual, hearing, et cetera. Take multiple medications, have high risks of hospitalization, and experience multiple providers, all which requires a lot of care coordination. And the same is true for people with disabilities. The goals of system engineering, as she identified them, are coordination, avoiding gaps, which I would say we have some gaps and part of what I'm going to address, reduced duplication, avoiding errors, and patient-centered. Engineering systems need to be patient-centered. So I highlighted that because that actual concept originates from disability research and disability advocacy, which was then adopted by the aging world. What we need from data and analytics, so to tie in with the previous panel, she identifies comprehensive patient-centered data. We're going to talk what the requirements of patient-centered data are, complete interoperability and data fluidity, community sources combined with healthcare sources, and patient and family access to information technology. So what's involved in access and what's involved in patient-centered data, really having patient-centered data systems and access to information technology. The primary focus areas of the PCAST report, if you haven't read it, are the key changes that older Americans often experience with aging. They focused on these four areas in particular: hearing loss, loss of social engagement and connectivity, cognitive change, and physical change. So the PCAST report came up with a total of 12 recommendations. I'm only using four of them here. These are the cross-cutting ones that cut across all types of technologies. There are another eight that are what they call issue specific. But I just want to focus on these because the first in a way and the last, integrating federal action. This has been in this area. This has been something that a lot of us have talked about within the federal government for the last few years. The fact that there is no pathway really from funding of R&D, from funding of development of technologies, to funding of the testing interventions using those technologies, to uptake, translation, et cetera. So this integrating federal action is the number one cross-cutting recommendation with the goal of identifying technologies vital to aging and to advise on sector-wide ways to advance technology. I would just pause here to say that NIA recently, the announcement is closed, but they had a funding announcement last year. The decision will be in September for what was called CART, a new funding initiative, which was called Collaborations
for Aging in Place Research Technologies.
Yes, Collaborations for Aging in Place Research Technologies. And it was an attempt. It's a NIH-led, but it's a cross-agency, cross-federal government-led initiative to try to establish some integrated federal action in this area, to actually build a platform to support this sort of pathway. And you can see the key agencies that are listed in the report that have responsibility for this. The next cross-cutting recommendation, engagement and social connectivity, which is derived from the literature on aging. We know that social connectivity is one of the key predictors of healthy aging. So I think that was a very progressive of the report. So the goal here is to establish a national plan to ensure access to internet communications, which are essential to health, social engagement, and well-being. And again, you see the agencies that are targeted. I would just note that HHS/ACL, ACL's Administration for Community Living, that's where my former agency, Neidler, was moved to recently within the last year and a half. Monitoring technology for frail and vulnerable elders. NIST was the only agency cited. And then finally, federal investments in research to spur innovation. So the call there was to support interdisciplinary and translational research, including robotics, advanced mobility technologies, communication technology, with special emphasis on cognitive training, home monitoring, and improving regulatory and payment systems, and home and product design, and a number of agencies. So those are that's the meat of the report. The report also went on to talk in depth about specific technologies. I am not going to do that. I think Roy will do a little bit of that. So that, Chris sent me four slides. I added one to it. So that's Chris's part of the report within the context of the PCAST. So now I want to highlight what I see as the intersection of the aging and disability experience, and what are the shared needs and opportunities for technology tools and products that computing science research can really be applied to. So if we look at it from the aging perspective, about one in every seven, or 14.1% of the U.S. population is an older American. So one in seven, 65 and over. If we look at it from the disability perspective, the American Community Survey estimates that in 2014, nearly one in eight persons, or 12.6% of the U.S. population, had a disability. The important thing is that these are not orthogonal populations. We have treated them in our policies and in our research agendas as orthogonal populations. We've caused a lot of duplication and silos because of that, but they are not orthogonal. So if you look at it from the intersection of aging and disability, of the U.S. population with disabilities in 2014, 51.6 were people of working age, 18 to 64, and 40.7 were people 65 and over. Again, looked at from the aging and disability perspective, of the six American Community Survey disability items, which include hearing loss, vision loss, mental health, self-care needs, and ambulatory difficulty was the most frequently cited type of disability, with the percentage increasing with age from 5.2% for 18 to 64-year-olds to 23% of persons 65 and over. So if we're looking at ambulatory disability, it's more prevalent among older adults. So one of the areas that I've really helped develop within research and policy circles is this notion of trying to characterize what is meant by aging with long-term disability versus aging into disability in later life. How are they similar? How are they different? What are their unique needs and what are their overlapping needs? So if you just look at it in perspective in terms of the examples of the most common diagnoses or chronic conditions, for people aging with disabilities, you're looking at populations such as in individuals with spinal cord injury, traumatic brain injury, neuromuscular disease, multiple sclerosis, developmental disabilities, post-polio syndrome, and we could add psychiatric disabilities and serious mental health issues to that as well. So if we're looking at people who are aging into disability over this magic divide of 65, most common diagnoses are osteoarthritis, COPD, vascular dementia, coronary artery disease, osteoporosis, diabetes, and complications of diabetes. So really quite separate diagnoses. But if you look at in terms of their shared risks, health risks, and their needs for technology, there's a lot of overlap. Shared health risks include risks of falls, chronic pain, risks for infections, need for caregiver support, cognitive impairment, depression, withdrawal, changes in vision and hearing, and mobility limitations. So lots of shared health risks. Shared needs for technology. I argue that they have a shared need to access accessible and usable assistive and advanced technology devices and systems to support shared goals. If you look at the literature and both aging and disability, all the survey research that AARP does, NIA, number of agencies, these are the four shared goals that both populations report. Healthy aging, they want to be healthy. They want to sustain and maximize function and independence. They want to live in the community. And they want to be socially and productively engaged. So these are also major opportunities for technology, obviously, to promote healthy aging, help sustain and maximize function and independence, support community living, and facilitate social and productive engagement. And we have furtive efforts, I would argue, to do so. Nidler, my former agency, funds a rehabilitation engineering research center on technologies for successful aging with disability, which Beth referred to. It happens to be at Georgia Tech now. Previously, it was at USC. And we funded in that space for about 20 years without getting much traction. But now that we're in HHS, I think a lot of traction is developing around that. So that's a very, very positive sign. Okay, so shared goals. So part three, key priorities for serving older adults and people with disabilities. That's the abbreviation for people with disabilities and the implications of this. So there are really three key priorities that I want to highlight today. You might call them requirements priorities. And the first two are the sort of companion concepts of accessibility and usability. So accessibility refers simply to ensuring an equivalent user experience for people with disabilities of all ages, an equivalent user experience. For example, it means that people with disabilities can perceive, understand, navigate, and interact with websites and IT tools and systems and participate without barriers. So it's about the ability to have an equivalent user experience and at all those levels, to perceive, to understand, to navigate, interact with websites without barriers. Usability refers to designing products to be effective, efficient, and satisfying. Something can be accessible and not satisfying, and obviously, conversely, something can be usable but not satisfying but not accessible. So there's legislative and regulatory support for accessibility. Obviously, I just cited two, the Americans with Disabilities Act and Section 508 of the Rehabilitation Act apply to health IT, although they are not consistently enforced and have not been tested in the court system. The law applies, but it has not been tested. Section 1557 of the Affordable Care Act prohibits discrimination on the basis of disability. And yet we still have major, major disparities in access to healthcare services and in health outcomes by disability status. Implementation guidelines for accessibility. Nidler has been funding development of the World Wide Web Consortium. It's located at MIT for years. and they offer free guidelines and tools and technical assistance that can enhance accessibility and interoperability. There are also web content accessibility guidelines to make content of websites more accessible. So this is just examples of some of the guidelines that are available to help on implementation. The third priority or recommendation is that of person-centered planning and services. This is interesting to how long it takes a concept to come of age. This concept grew out of the White House Conference on Aging in 1990. And it is just now being codified across the federal government by ONC, by CMS, by Administration for Community Living, but that's the trail on that concept, person-centered planning and services. So what does it mean? It refers to a process that is directed by the person and identifies the strengths, preferences, service and support needs, and desired outcomes of the person, consistent with the person's health, cultural preferences, housing, family, employment, and social support needs. That's available on the ACL website. It applies to both healthcare delivery systems and access to healthcare, as well as to home and community-based long-term services and supports. Legislative and policy support, Affordable Care Act, Section 2402, Oversight and Assessment of the Administration of Home and Community-Based Services. More recently, the HHS Secretary's guidance on implementation of that section. And then also the Office of the National Coordinator in their 2015 to 2020 strategic plan for a national interoperability roadmap provides a framework for health IT to empower individuals, families, and caregivers through improved health management and engagement, and uses language of person-centeredness also. So these are the three key priorities. So that I think when we're talking about personalization, and I'm drawing on the previous panel, talked about personalizing the experience of technology. For older adults and for people with disabilities, these are the three priorities that need to be addressed to really personalize the experience of technology. It must be accessible, it must be usable, and it must be person-centered. Anyone in the room knows Frances West from IBM. Speaking of IBM, somebody used to work at IBM. She's now the chief of worldwide accessibility, something like that for IBM. And she says that accessibility is really the ultimate in personalization, because with accessibility we can get down to designing for ends of one. And so it's very much consistent with those kinds of concepts. So what are the implications if we really take seriously these three priorities of serving older adults and people with disabilities? What are the implications? And here I'm drawing on learning health systems. I should have probably come after the next presenter. So, but if we take these three priorities or concepts seriously, I think it has implications for how we think of learning health systems or any kind of learning computer-based systems. It allows us to broaden the definition of learning health systems beyond the healthcare system itself to include the patient, the family, and/or caregiver system. It also allows us to reflect bidirectional learning and engagement, and not just learning and engagement within the system. It allows us to expand the model of learning health systems model beyond the goal of change in practice to include improved health and function outcomes for older adults and people with disabilities. So not just change in practice, but if we look at our logic models, what's the end goal of change in practice? It's to improve outcomes. So when you can't do that without engaging the end users, and systems have to be accessible and usable in order to do that. And finally, the implication of these three priorities for the learning health system is that it encourages the system to adopt the priorities of accessibility and usability from disability and the values of person-centered planning services from aging and disability to ensure that learning health systems and technologies are usable by and reflective of the needs of both target populations. So implications of the aging and disability priorities for an inclusive computing research agenda. I think first and foremost, we need to elevate accessibility and usability as a recognized national priority for all new and emerging health information and other advanced technologies. It is, instead of subsuming it underneath or attaching it after the fact, it needs to become a national priority in itself. all these systems where we're involving the public and end users and consumers need to be accessible and usable, and that needs to be recognized as a national priority. So I would argue elevating it to that level. We need to integrate requirements for incorporating accessibility and usability standards and guidelines into all federal funding initiatives. We need to involve stakeholders in the process of identifying national priorities for technology R&D to ensure that person-centered principles are followed. Broad-based stakeholders. And we need to provide researchers, developers, designers, and vendors with resources and training on accessibility standards and guidelines, because there is not much cross-pollination on these concepts and these topics among different disciplines and between the aging and disability, researchers and experts on one side and computer science experts on the other. And then finally, implications for aging and disability priorities within the PCAST report. The PCAST report had an opportunity, and I hope in their implementation this will still be possible, to reduce federal silos in technology R&D policy and funding initiatives by expanding the target populations to include both older adults and individuals aging with disabilities. Right now, we really have had separate silos. And this CART initiative, again, collaborative research in aging in place using technology, does not specify the target populations. It could be open to people with disabilities as well as older adults. So that's an N of one. We have an example of one so far. Another implication for the PCAST report recommendations is expand federal involvement to include NIDLR, the U.S. Access Board, and other disability regulatory and R&D agencies. Third, incorporate accessibility and usability as a priority in all cross-cutting and issue-specific recommendations. So we don't just need these systems, we need them to be accessible and usable. And finally, involve disability researchers, developers, policy experts, and advocates in all federal and public-private task forces charged with identifying technologies vital to aging, developing a national research plan, and educational and training materials, improving regulation and payment systems, and product design standards, and in shaping the future of assistive and robotic technologies. So basically, to reduce the federal silos and reduce the disciplinary silos and really develop an inclusive computing research agenda for the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Terrific, Chuck.
I'm up.
You're up.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here, and I feel truly privileged to have the opportunity to speak to you about this concept of the learning health system that Margaret already alluded to. Let me just take a quick poll. How many of you in this room have heard of this learning health system concept? Okay, I'm calibrated. So I have to begin with a disclosure, and I will be referring actually to this grassroots, not-for-profit learning health community a bit later in my talk. Okay, so what is it? You can read some very, very long and rococo definitions of a learning health system, and I could spend actually the whole 15 minutes I have reading just one of them to you, and I'm not going to do that. And instead, I'm going to present a very concise definition of what a learning health system is, and it basically is seen at the top of that slide. A health system at any level of scale, and I can emphasize this issue of scale, it's very important, can become a learning health system when it acquires the capability to continuously and routinely study and improve itself. I think that captures the essence of what a learning health system is, and I think if many of you in the meeting today can probably have already in your own work applied this very, very basic concept. The idea is not mine. I wish I could claim credit for it. It was actually developed by the U.S. Institute of Medicine, now the National Academy of Medicine, at a meeting they held in 2006, and it was first expressed publicly in a report that appeared in 2007. Since that time, it has been written about and talked about by many people and in many places. One prominent article by Arnold Milstein is noted here, where he said that one of the three things the U.S. absolutely must do to safely reduce the GDP footprint of healthcare in this country is adopt the concept of a learning health system. So I'm going to give you three ways to think about what a learning health system is. I'm going to talk about it as an inspiring idea, and in the process of doing that, I'm going to say quite a bit more about what it actually is and how it works. Then I will talk about it as an emerging reality. Things are happening. The needle is moving in this space. And the third point I'm going to make is perhaps the most interesting of all. As a result of a sequence of events that began in 2013 and that I certainly could not have envisioned at that time, it appears that this learning health system concept might be pointing us toward what some people have called a new science, and whether you want to call it that or not will probably depend on how you react to the ideas I present, but I will put that idea in front of you. So let's begin with inspiration. I think inspiration changes the world, and that people are naturally drawn to visionary ideas. I left the word idea out of there, that stimulate their imagination. I think healthcare and health have been looking for a long time for such a stimulating idea, and certainly for me, and as I hope to convince you by the end of this talk, for a good deal of other people, this learning health system might be the big idea that we've needed for a long time. I don't know quite why this is the case. You can take the three words apart and say that one reason may be that it is the combination of three words that have highly positive connotations, and perhaps there is some highly positive interaction among them. But this idea seems to captivate people, stimulate their imaginations, and spur them to action. Beth has already shown this slide. She has already gotten you depressed, so I don't have to do it. I will just add one item she did not include on her slide, and that is the cultural issue that medicine is really characterized by a culture of blame. When people make a mistake, we want to punish them, rather than a culture of safety, where mistakes are viewed as opportunities to learn. And as a consequence of this culture, it's very hard to learn, because numerous studies cite the fact that less than 10% of misadventures in healthcare are actually reported. So how can you learn from something you don't know about? I will also show you, just to pile on here, the Commonwealth Fund's rankings of eight national health systems from a report they produced in 2013. And you can see at the bottom of that report the fact that we spend just about twice as much per capita on health as any of these 10 other nations. And if you look at the criteria on which the performance of their health systems as systems are ranked, and do some calculus which combines them that the Commonwealth Fund did, we come in 11th out of 11, and that's bad. The polarity of this is that you want a lower score. So this is, the 11 there is not a good thing. So that's why we need a learning health system. And the people who have, like me, really adopted this idea, become enthusiastic about it, have tried to implement it, and now are looking at the science that lies underneath it, we've actually developed some themes. I'm actually trying to set these to music, and if anybody has any ideas, I would be I'd be interested. The one idea I have is learn from every patient. That could be probably set to the tune of Climb Every Mountain. It's got one too many syllables, but it's close enough. But the idea here is that in this digital age, and as the care of individuals and by the healthcare system, and the care of individuals for themselves, as we look at the quantified self and other health data generating activities, is creating a digital footprint about every patient and about every care episode. And if we can find a way to do this, we can literally learn from the experience of every patient by looking across patients with similar problems, looking across a given patient's own history, and improve the system from that process. Back to the word system. We have the best trained health workforce in the world, bar none. So our problem, what gives rise to, I'm going to blame it on you, Beth's slides about the state of our healthcare system, it's not a person, it's not a person power problem, it's a system problem. And a system problem needs a system solution. So that's another anthem. And the third anthem of the learning health system goes to the notion that it takes too long to learn. Our system does learn, but it learns too slowly. The well-documented latency between the discovery of valuable new biomedical knowledge and its widespread use in practice is pretty well documented to be in the double digits of years. 17 is what's cited, so I'll use that, but really think of it as an order of magnitude. The learning health system has the promise to shorten, and there are some examples of its application that have done this, this latency from 17 years to 17 months to 17 weeks to 17 days, and maybe in a public health emergency even to 17 hours, where we could develop where we could envision a system that could learn about a public health emergency, detect it, and figure out, suggest ways to respond to it on that kind of time scale. Okay, well, so what is it? Anthems are all well and good, but at some point you have to talk about what it is, and that's what I'm going to do now. And I'm going to give you three views of the learning health system because it is a system concept, and to really get your arms around it, it's very important to come at it from different directions. The first is what I call a checklist view. This is what an assayer might have on his or her clipboard if they walked into a healthcare delivery environment and tried to figure out if this health system is a learning health system. Here are the things that might be on their checklist. Is every consenting patient's characteristics and experience available to learn from? Is this best practice knowledge, what you learn from this activity, from these digital footprints, immediately available to support decisions? That's the knowledge derived, not the raw data. Does this go on continuously? In other words, every health system has the capable of learning and correcting itself in a bursty fashion. But then when a problem arises, it makes some changes, and then it goes dormant. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about this going on continuously. Is there an infrastructure in place that enables this to happen routinely and with economy of scale? If each of these learning activities is a tub on its own bottom, we have a system that can't support itself. And finally, is all of this part of the culture? If you walk around and ask people why they do this, the only answer they'll give you if it's part of the culture is, well, this is who we are and what we do here. Five characteristics on a checklist. Now we'll take you up to Earth orbit and look down on a learning health system from a very high altitude. And I would submit to you this is what you, at least metaphorically, see. You'd see something that's all-inclusive. There's a kind of nuclear physics a hypothesis about the learning health system that if any one stakeholder group, and you see many of the important stakeholder groups depicted in this picture, is not included in a learning health system, it becomes unstable like an atomic nucleus that loses a neutron and eventually disintegrates. So it must be all-inclusive. It must be trusted. All of these stakeholders have to trust the system to operate in a way that does do the five things I talked about in my checklist view. Most people believe this is this has to be a decentralized system in the spirit of the internet. It can't have one central point of control, and I am certainly not talking about all the health data in the country going to, heaven help us, Washington, D.C., where it will be analyzed by central people in some central place. This is a system where the data will exist in many places and will be brought together when it is necessary to do so. And finally, it's reciprocal. You see the two-way arrows there. All of these stakeholders will put something in. They will all get something out. They'll each put in something different. They'll each get something different out. But in the end of the day, if the system is going to be sustainable, the net value of what they get out has to exceed the cost of what they put in. The third view, having taken you up to many miles of elevation, is the view from the ground, and this is how learning happens. And it happens by a very familiar process. This notion of a virtuous cycle of assembly of data, analysis of data, interpretation of results, creation of messages back to decision makers who are in a position to take action, the taking of action, which changes the state of the system and drives the next cycle, the notion being that improvement will occur relative to whatever problem of interest brought this community together over time and successive iterations of this cycle. I will illustrate this with a very pertinent example, given the interests of the other of my colleagues on the panel, the very serious problem of falls in nursing homes. And a virtuous cycle would begin with a decision by some group of nursing homes at some level of scale. This could be every nursing home in the country. It could be all the nursing homes in a state or owned by a given corporate entity. They'd forms a community that would come together to study falls and would actually govern. This was collective action by a community, the problem of falls and how to reduce it. They would assemble data about how this is done now. They would analyze the data, and then they'd sit down as a community and basically say, did we learn anything? Are these results credible, and what advice should be given? If the results are not credible, the process short circuits and you go back to 6 o'clock. But if there is something learned in the opinion of this community, you would send tailored messages, in this case probably back to the administrators of the nursing home, which basically says you already told us what you currently do. Based on what you currently do, you may want to consider, because we learned from the variation in practice across the community, these following things that you're not doing now, which appear to work. Then these nursing homes would take action. Some of them would do precisely what was recommended. Some of them would do none of it. Some of them would do some of it. And some of them would say, you know, I'm not going to do any of this, but you gave us some new ideas, so we're going to do something different, because this is people, and this is the way people respond to feedback. All of that will change the state of the system, and the cycle will continue. So a lot of people think the learning health system is big data. And I just want to disabuse anybody who might think that of that notion once and for all. The learning health system is much bigger than big data. And one way to understand that is to look at this simple idea that better health requires the NIH's notion of big data to knowledge, accompanied by this feedback side of the virtuous cycle, K to P, or knowledge to practice. So what you need is the left side of the cycle and the right side of the cycle. So better health requires this, but unfortunately, if we just focus on big data, what we will get is this, and the knowledge that is generated by these big data exercises will go in journals where what will happen? It will sit for 17 years. Thank you. We do a duet.
Yeah,
this would be great. What a team. finally, this is a talk in and of itself. But I think this community intuitively gets the idea that if we're going to learn at scale, we need an infrastructure or platform to support it. And one way of looking at this diagrammatically is to envision a platform as a ring. which is a socio-technical platform consisting of people, policy, technology, and practice, which supports multiple different learning cycles, hundreds of them at scale, going on simultaneously, each addressing its own problem, and each of them cycling at a pace that is concomitant with the nature of the problem being addressed. I'm going to pick up the pace now, an emerging reality. So one, I'm going to talk to you about several channels of progress to suggest that this is actually happening. I'm not inventing this, although I've invented things in the past, I'm not doing it now. So progress. One line of progress is writings and policies. There are books, there are articles, and actually Margaret referred to the federal policy goal expressed in the Office of the National Coordinator's roadmap and strategic plan, and they specifically target, as official federal policy direction, a learning health system by 2024. Then we have examples of organizations, including the organization that Chris Castle, had she been here, is currently employed by, of learning health systems at their levels of scale. These are organizations that do what I just described. They do it routinely. You could check all the boxes on the checklist, and they do it for all their patients and all the conditions they treat. That's good news. Bad news is the way they do it is completely idiosyncratic, and they can't connect with what we call learning. They can't connect with other learning islands because they developed their own way of doing it over many decades. Better news is the complement to this. There are growing all over the country now, faster than anybody can keep track of it, interorganizational data federations and learning networks. Five examples you see here, and these are interorganizational, so they can't function as islands or organizational walled gardens, but as a consequence of that, they typically focus on a subset of diseases, which is fine, and they also have the feature that they are scalable. Now, the Sentinel Initiative, which exists for the sole purpose of doing post-market drug surveillance, can actually now do in about 2 weeks what used to take 6 months, and that is answer a question on a national scale using 150 million patients, whether there exists a significant side effect from a particular drug. These queries used to take 6 months, now they take 2 weeks. Then this grassroots community, as a result of a summit that took place in 2012 and sort of defined what the core values underlying a learning health system is, there has emerged a mailing list of about 2,500 people and now 101 organizational supporters, endorsers, of a set of core values, and this is the essence of this learning health community. What I'd like to point out here, and you can confirm this very quickly with a quick scan of these organizations. Every stakeholder group that I portrayed in my Earth orbit view of what a learning health system would look like is in fact included in this community. And finally, a portal to a new science. So here's another good news and bad news. I think the good news here is that there is clear progress toward a much needed, what I call version one of a learning health system, a sort of clunky system that will work and probably do a lot of good in the world. The bad news is we don't really know what we're doing yet and how to make this thing hum, how to make it work at scale, how to put those learning islands together, how to allow these networks to interoperate, how to make the system sustainable. So actually a learning health system, although it's been compared to a moonshot, it's actually much harder than rocket science, at least in my opinion. Now in recognition of this, the National Science Foundation, thanks to Dr. Wachtler here in the audience, funded a workshop in 2013 to begin viewing the learning health system as a science, or at least a set of problems, a set of scientific problems that would have to be addressed if we are going to realize not clunky version 1.0, but a high-functioning version of a learning health system. And we put about 45 people in the room, including several who are here, and not surprisingly, we got a lot of research questions out of this group, 106 to be exact, organized into four categories and 19 subcategories, published in an article in the Journal of the American Medical Informatics Association. But equally important, with the clock ticking down and about 20 minutes left in the workshop, Ben Schneiderman stood up, struck a pose very much like the one you see there, and said, you know, what's really happened today that's most important, or in this workshop that's most important, is that we're thinking differently and we may be on the cusp of discovering a new science, a new way of thinking, a new way of approaching a very important set of problems. And this led to another workshop for which we also were fortunate to have NSF support that occurred in conjunction with the HICS meeting in 2015, organized by Kevin Sullivan. I won't tease him about this picture, but that's Kevin. And identified a nascent scientific community and really began to probe this idea of how the thinking, the scientific thinking, the conceptual thinking related to a learning health system might differ from the way we conventionally, at least in the biomedical community, look at problems. And Bill Stead, shown in the bottom right slide there, a very creative fellow, provided this slide, which addresses some of these differences. So that has led, and this is my penultimate slide, to the plan and commitment that the CCC will be supporting a series of workshops this year, later this year, and early next year, looking at this concept of a science underlying this kind of learning systems, which we are now calling cyber-social learning systems, thanks to Kevin, and viewing it as a concept that applies not only to health, but virtually any endeavor, any human endeavor, which has high value and therefore should be seen as something to be continuously improved. So these workshops carry an evolution in two directions. The notion of crossing domains, which I spoke about, and also a natural extension from the NSF's concept of well-established concept of cyber-physical systems now to a concept of cyber-social systems, where what is computing is not just people in conjunction with devices, but people as decision makers, people organized into social units, and those social units organized into higher level organizations. I've somewhat wistfully described this workshop as modelable as a wicket. If you think about the way we're going to do this, we're going to look at the cross-cutting science of cyber-social learning systems in the context of three specific domains: health, education, and smart and connected communities. So that concludes my remarks. I have described to you what I hope you see as an idea that has really energized very, very large numbers of people, a goal toward which progress is being made, and finally a challenge for which new ideas and maybe even a new science may be necessary to fully achieve it. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. I have the inevitable position of being the last speaker before we ask questions, but I'm going to do something a little bit differently. First, my talk is really more at the ground level view. But I'm going to start with a little video that might give you some perspective.
In the United States alone, 1 in 7 people that has a disability of some kind that impairs their activities of daily living. And technology It has tremendous potential for improving the lives of people with disabilities.
I was serving in the Army as a sergeant in Europe when I was injured, and I came home with a spinal cord injury and had to use a wheelchair. There was like an 80-pound behemoth that I could hardly get in the car. I realized that there were a tremendous need for improving technology, improving the environment, and improving perceptions of people with disabilities. When the opportunity arose to work with the University of Pittsburgh and the VA Pittsburgh healthcare system, it was natural that we'd start HURL.
The laboratory, our mission is to improve the quality of life for people with disabilities through advanced research or engineering, get people more integrated into the community and to make them more independent. We do this through some of our programs that we have here, whether it's educational or research or outreach.
We've started out as a wheelchair lab doing sort of manual wheelchair work and have expanded over the years to include brain-computer interfaces, robotics, virtual reality, cognitive aids, home modifications, and training.
The system that you see behind me, that's called the CARE system, or the computer-assisted rehab environment. We work with people who have gotten prosthetic limbs, so in terms of how are they adapting to a newer technology. One of the latest technologies that's come out from University of Pittsburgh is the brain-computer interface, a robotic arm directly getting signals from the brain. So we're trying to see if we can get that technology, use it to drive wheelchairs much more efficiently, not just control left or right.
We have a machine shop where we can basically fabricate anything mechanically or electronically that we wish. What's kind of unique is not too many university programs allow you to do the design, but also do the fabrication and take you through all of those steps.
This is our robotics lab. Everything you see here has something to do with robotics.
We developed this called the Strong Arm, which is a robotic-assisted transfer device. This mounts to the wheelchair, folds up behind them.
We've developed ones mainly to replace upper extremity function for people, and then we're working on ones that can actually lift the person.
I think 10 years down the line will be something you would see used quite frequently and have tremendous impact on people's lives.
I was in the United States Marine Corps for 15 years. I was medically retired after being injured in Iraq.
Many of our people in HURL are themselves veterans, and many of them work clinically in the VA.
Press that bottom button until that says set.
I ended up here through an internship program called Elevate, and this program was designed for people to transition from the military back into academics who have any type of interest in assistive technology, engineering, and research.
Since our inception, we wanted to include veterans with disabilities in HURL as employees, as trainees, to reach out to them.
The experience I had transitioning through the programs here and the work that we do here really put a passion fire inside of me to give back to the community, not only the veteran community, but others with disabilities like myself.
Our research is continuously evolving as we can adopt new technologies and information from other fields of science that have influenced us. The end goal for us is full autonomy and full participation in society as equal partners and respect for people with disabilities. So I think we have a lifetime's worth of work ahead of us.
We taught from day one, we're not doing anything for charity, we're helping people to be themselves so that they can do better. You're not taking care of people, you're helping people take care of themselves.
Great, well, I hope you enjoyed that. What I love about that most, actually, is Deepon, is one of our doctoral students, his comment in the end, right? That's you can see that the students also really get what our mission is, and you see also the students with and without disabilities working together. I also think what kind of helps learn, too, is that you see that people with disabilities are computer scientists and engineers and physicians and therapists. They're people all of us have play multiple roles in our lives. Let me go through our slides so we can get to our discussion. Can I control this or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right here.
Okay. Wasn't sure. So one of the things that I was good is that Chuck and Margaret, I think, did a great job of providing an overview. Noticed a couple things that, unfortunately, we coordinated our talks a little bit. Since you're in computer science, you may not be fully aware that one of the goals, I mean, there are several documents that are also important to look at. The Americans with Disabilities Act has already been mentioned, but the ICF is a framework adopted by the WHO and the UN that we use in the United States in research and more in our clinical practice, at least in the educational clinical practice, International Classification of Functioning. One of the things that I think is sort of most important shift in our paradigm with the ICF was that disability is actually the interaction of impairment, the environment, and that environment, including the individual environment, the social environment, the physical environment, and the virtual environment in the case of the World Wide Web, for example. Another report you should take a look at if you get the chance is the World Report on Disability, which has a lot of the statistics that you saw today, but puts them in a worldwide context. I don't know if you heard, you know, John Kerry's speech at Northeastern. He said that the students graduating today are going to grow up in a world without borders. And in some ways, that's what this World Health Report looks at, too. Disability, aging, those are global issues, not just issues that were facing us in the United States. And into the same, and along the same lines, that those two documents led to the UN Convention on Human Rights for People with Disabilities, which is actually built some ways on our Americans with Disabilities Act, as well as the our goal for 25 years now that people with disabilities and older adults would be involved in their own health care and decisions about their own health care. That's codified, actually, in the UN Convention on Human Rights for People with Disabilities. So we can... I actually think that one of the things we need to look at is the power of wireless technologies. So being computer scientists, computer engineers, I am the only computer engineer on the panel, I guess. Is that there's going to be, could be 100 billion connected IoT devices and $11 trillion industry in 2025. What I fear is that older adults and people with disabilities get left behind, and we create a new digital divide. And so it's early enough, but on the other hand, I'm hopeful that it has tremendous potential for improving the lives of people with disabilities and older adults, and including them in our, in promoting greater inclusion in our society. But it goes back to what Margaret said about accessibility and usability. That picture, by the way, is not just a gratuitous picture. That's the breezy Samsung product that they're actually looking at changing the interface for tablet computing in order to allow individuals with intellectual disabilities access to computing environments in a safe way. One of the innovative features of that is that the programming and sort of control in order to ensure safety and privacy can be turned over to a remote caregiver. And so that also allows for tuning. It's also interesting, it allows some tracking of data as well on connectedness and usability. Next slide. Oh, sorry. So I think another message I want you to take is that computing technology actually makes things possible for many people with disabilities. For many of you, it is a labor-saving device, maybe a tool for enhancing your productivity or even allowing you new avenues of research and collaboration. For many people with disabilities, it is their lifeline. And it can promote community participation and through health and employment and family. The goal is it becomes an extension of the user. These are just some examples. On the far right is as Howard knows quite well, is our PERMA, the Personal Mobility Manipulation Appliance. The idea is it's a robotic mobility device with bimanual robotic manipulators. It can be operated by the user or operated by a remote caregiver or in some combination. These pictures are primarily of an early version. But that's led to work, if you see, if we move to the left, the upper left, we're working on a virtual seating coach. It became a commercial product in March of this year through a company called Permobile, but it allows individuals to learn from each other, learn through their clinicians, share data with their clinician using sensors on the chair and a smartphone in order to promote healthy usage of power seat functions. And that's important for prevention of pressure ulcers and lymphedema, which is swelling of the lower extremities. But now we're seeing, you know, brain-computer interfaces, also using, what's amazing there is the plasticity of the brain, and also learning about how that plasticity of the brain actually can change with use or disuse, which has led to such technologies as the DARPA, Revolutionary Prosthetic Arm, which in the lower picture, that's actually Fred Downs, a Vietnam veteran and used to be the Assistant Secretary of the VA for Procurement Prosthetics, using that DARPA Revolutionary Prosthetic Arm, using, interestingly enough, now he's not using a brain-computer interface like the person in the middle, but he is using a smart device that reads actually how he changes the pressure in his shoes in order to change to move the elbow, the shoulder, and the gripper. So I already mentioned sort of coaching healthy behavior. I think that is something that if you look on just for example, on the Apple App Store, there are already about 1,000 apps for coaching healthy behavior. The quality of those apps and how well they actually promote healthy behavior is yet unknown, but it's growing literally month to month. I think this is a tremendous opportunity for learning about contextual awareness, integrating medical health data, the learning health system, and then I also think this is going to be about the virtualized self, or how we know about how we study ourselves as well. If you look on the left of that slide, that's the Wounded Warrior Home Project, integrating this technology actually into the home environment to promote greater family connectedness and full inclusion of people with disabilities. Also, the interesting thing is this was a project we did with the Department of the Army, and we built 2 of these homes at Fort Belvoir. Later, 100 homes were built. It also keeps soldiers connected while they're deployed. So it realizes that the dynamic of families today has changed, where you might have an older adult or a child or a family member with a disability living with you. You have people of all different generations and people that are in the home and out of the home over different periods of time. And how do you keep them connected? And how can technology promote that? So, and I think that the Internet of Things will enable interaction between people with disabilities, their physical environment, and their support network. So these are sort of graphically ill things here. As you notice, I also remarked that people with disabilities are a highly heterogeneous group, with having each individual have their own unique needs, abilities, and resources, much like older adults. One of the things I think that's really possible is, for example, I'll just give you this today. When I parked in the garage today, I had to find the sign to where the accessible parking spaces were. But with something like beacon technology, I could come in and it could tell me where are the accessible spaces and which ones are open, which where could I park. I had to find the sign to indicating where the ramp was to get it to the elevators. I had to find the button to open the door to get on the elevator. When I got on the elevator, it only took me to the lobby level. I had to find the elevator to get here. I think the Internet of Things has an idea so that I'm not searching, but the world is aware of my presence and my needs and communicate that to me. And if you can imagine, if you're visually impaired and you're looking for this information, it's even much more complex. And so I think we need to move, too, into studying people's needs and behaviors in the real world, not in a laboratory environment or necessarily in the clinical environment. But So I'm coining that sort of around me technologies, what's around me. So if I'm in my car going to a parking garage, hopefully the system is smart enough to realize personalize to me that I'm looking for a parking space. Once I've parked my car, it could make the assumption that I'm looking for the entrance to the building and the pathways to accessible entrance to the building. So that's back to the idea of I not only see personalized health, as we heard about, but also a personalized world. Perfect. I think that's it.
All right, thank you. So we'll go ahead and invite questions from the audience, and I have one as people make their way to the microphones. And Clayton, I see you moving, so I'm not going to ask your question because I'm going to guess a little bit as to what that's going to be. But I want to talk about the role of kind of, we've mentioned a number of regulations and different programs that create mandates out there for the community and the relationship between those and technology innovation. And the short story is at Georgia Tech, when we started on our work with home technologies, we said we were going to work on in a warehouse and we were going to work in aging in place. And that lasted until someone said, yes, we're building a warehouse for the elderly. All right, and as soon as someone said warehouse for elderly, we decided that that might not be the best branding and name to use for that, so it became an aware home. But I'm struck by the distinction in regulations and mandates around medically safe existence in the home versus mandates for an engagement, equal engagement within the community. And I was curious about how you think those different types of mandates or perspectives about what technology is supposed to achieve affects or impacts the innovation that we see out there. And I'm pass this to Rory first, because I know we've talked about this, but I think there's a huge difference in what we want technology to happen for us and the extent that we think the equal engagement by people who are older, people with disabilities, makes a difference in what we create.
Great, that's a complicated question, but I think the goal is not to design for people with disabilities or for older adults, but design for everyone.
Yep.
So when we took, for example, the approach with the Wounded Warrior Home, we looked at connecting children, parents, perhaps an older adult, people of multiple generations living in a home. Maybe another way to think about it, this is, are many families live in a home over the life of the home versus looking at the perspective of our own life. And so accommodating the people that may live in the home over the life of the home. And then you can see that how you would need to connect people as they change over their lifespan from being an infant to, rather cradle to grave, right?
Yep.
I mean, over the entire lifespan and anticipating what might happen to them over that lifespan. So I think this actually comes back, a lot of it comes back to learning systems and also being able to personalize to individuals' preferences and abilities.
Any other ads, or we'll go to the...
Yes, I'd like to add a little bit of that. I don't know if you were thinking of these particular examples, but if you look at the marketplace, of course, there's just burgeoning startups in the area of care coordination and caregiver support in the home, home mm-hmm. settings, and some monitoring. A lot of that involves monitoring, et cetera. I mean, literally, if I subscribe to an aging-in-place technology e-alert, you probably mm-hmm. do too, and literally every week... plethora, just unbelievable numbers of startups in this area. But most of those products, first of all, are not accessible. Mm-hmm. And there's no requirements for that. Guidelines for accessibility are, voluntary at this point, for the most part. And when the U.S. Access Board gets involved, then it gets a little bit more regulatory. But in terms of the home industry, the home is the setting for delivery of home and community-based services in terms of technology-related services like home monitoring, et cetera, there aren't any mandates that mm-hmm. govern that. Mm-hmm. And it's a very active marketplace. And it's a very difficult marketplace to navigate if you're a family or an individual who is older and has a disability or younger and has a disability, very difficult to navigate. Also, the other big gap in terms of a systems engineering perspective, there's been no evidence base for most of those products and most of those systems. That's the trouble with this lack of this pathway, how we take it from the R&D all the way through to developing, you know, evidence of safety and efficacy and effectiveness. So those are huge gaps in funding, and it affects the quality of the product and the service, you know, to the individuals. So, and we can, there's just so many examples along that kind of line that we can point to. And I think it makes the marketplace of the Internet of Things for older adults and people with disabilities very difficult to navigate.
And if I could throw in a quick comment, I don't know how many of you have read Atul Gawande's book called On Being Mortal.
Yep.
I think anyone who is going to do design in this space needs to read that book.
Yep. Thank you. Clayton, you want to kick off?
Yeah, Clayton Lewis, University of Colorado. And I'm going to cheat. I'm not asking a question. I'm going to embroider and second things that Margaret and Rory were
Thank
saying
you,
for the benefit of the larger audience. So I hope many of you saw that you, as computer scientists, are working on issues and problems directly related to what Margaret and Rory were talking about. And to emphasize that, there's a pretty much brand new CCC white paper on computer science research for inclusion online. And a major theme in that report is going through existing and potential research in computer science and highlighting the opportunities for computer scientists to contribute to this agenda. Indeed, many of you will find that you're already contributing to the agenda, but you don't know it. And as a result, your work isn't necessarily directly hitting some of the targets that it could hit. Just a few examples. If you're working on information visualization, if you're working on recognition technology, if you're working on natural language processing, if you're working on end-user programming, you're working on problems that really can be targeted towards the kind of agenda that Rory and Margaret have laid out. So I hope that many of you have a look at that CCC white paper.
Thank you, Clayton. Do we have copies of that one out? We do. Question from the rear.
Hi, Matt Beetz, University of California, Irvine. Thanks. This has been a very interesting panel. And I wanted to bring up something that I think cuts across all three of the speakers' presentations. And in particular, what we've been talking about is an inherently cross-sector activity, that we've invoked the marketplace several times. The visualization of the learning health system ecosystem had partners that were coming from a lot of different areas. And, you know, when we're talking about something like aging and health, where we're talking about parts of the edges of populations, we know the marketplace actually isn't particularly good at serving the edges of populations. And there's been some work on this that's showing up not only in sort of accessibility in a traditional sense, but even things like, we know, for example, that Fitbits are trained on healthy young people, and so there's been some research documenting that they can be off on step counts for elderly people by up to 25%. So we have this space where we also know, for example, that there's a strong, when we include corporate partners in an ecosystem that is focused on data sharing, there are a lot of incentives for corporations not to share their data and to keep that in-house, and issues that come with moving that data across those boundaries. And maybe this is foreshadowing tomorrow a little bit, but I guess I'd like to ask you to comment a little bit on the role of public-private partnerships or other models for thinking about how to cross those boundaries in this space.
Excellent question. Back in September of 2015, my former agency Nidler and ONC and several other federal agencies sponsored a conference on a long title, of course. Whenever you try to bridge aging and disability, you get long titles because you have to touch certain, you know, keystones. So it was accessibility and usability in health information technology, empowering older adults, people with disabilities, and caregivers. And one of the most exciting parts of that, we brought together five different stakeholder groups designers, developers, federal policymakers, researchers, industry representatives, including IBM and several other big ones. And one of the most exciting panels was on exactly this question of public-private partnerships, how to catalyze them, how to get them started. And Francis West from IBM was representing industry, and David Lindemann, who is was the director of the Center for Technology and Aging and now is part of Citrus at UC Berkeley. I mean, it's not just UC Berkeley, it's the UC system. I think Citrus stands for Collaborative Information Technology Research in Services Society or something like that. Anyway, and they have a very interesting model. They're really pioneering this idea of public-private partnerships and how to put them together. And but one of the takeaways from that panel at the September conference was that the federal government is the problem. The federal government is the lack of integration among agencies, the lack of the pathway that the federal government is really the problem. And I think that's what I find exciting about the PCAST report, is that we really need to operationalize and really drill down to identify the ways in which the federal government is the problem and how we can fix it. Because it is going to take that kind of public-private partnership. Joseph Coughlin at MIT has been calling for that for years in terms of technology and aging. So I think that that's something we need policy experts and other kinds of experts across disciplines to really study that. How do we need to disaggregate the silos in the federal government so that we can catalyze these and incentivize these public-private partnerships and fund them?
So I'd like to make two points from the perspective of the learning health system. One is the grassroots nature of the organ of the system, which basically allows for any problem to be the subject of study, the formation of a virtuous cycle, if a community forms around it. So if there is some underserved group and a recognition that that group is underserved and something needs to be done to rectify that, as long as the community forms to address that problem, the system can address it. The second goes to this notion of coopetition, that that entities that compete on many aspects of what they do often come together and decide not to compete on particular other aspects. And I think in the formation of these learning networks that we're witnessing the rapid growth of now, we are seeing a phenomenon like that, where organizations that do compete are willing to share data, not all of their data, and this is why the decentralization of the learning health system is so important, but data relevant to the solution of a particular problem, because they see it to be a matter of public health and safety or a greater good to do that. I'm frequently asked this question about whether competing organizations will come together, and the best answer to suggest that they will is that they are.
Terrific. We have time for more questions, and I have one that I want to pose to the panel and to the audience, and then Anne's giving me the we're finished soon sign. So we have been looking at the relationship of Internet of Things and data science within, as you mentioned, the wickets of health and city and education really throughout the entire day. And one of the questions that I had, especially that comes up when we start looking at aging with disability in the home, is we start to get to kind of quite unique data points, right, when you add all of those variables together. Should our community, this is really to everyone in the room, should our community focus on N equals one kind of highly personalized systems that in some sense embrace all of that diversity of data? And then let the learning part kind of sort itself out in aggregation? Or should we go, and I think it's in my mind a critique of some of the things that we've seen, maybe even in the CART RFA, trying to replicate the medical healthcare model of standardized instruments across home environments and trying to make it as homogeneous as possible within the lens of kind of big data science. And you're not allowed to say both, but from your experience of especially with, you know, disability and aging, you know, do you agree with my contention that we really need to focus on N equals one optimization and then learn from that, or do we really want to focus on kind of big data standardization perspectives, which I can agree with the folks in the morning, we need to do that for climate science, but do we really need to do that for healthcare?
Chuck? Margaret, you want me to go first?
I'm going to start with you.
Okay.
Because you've been staring at this longer than I have.
No, I'm with, on balance with the N equals one, and one of the reasons why I believe this, and it goes to a point I buried in my remarks, that variation is the stuff of learning.
Mm-hmm.
And if we standardize, mm-hmm. we can't learn from it. So if you think about a continuously adaptive process where people will react to messages they receive in different ways, inevitably, we have a system that continues to generate variation. And I think that's a good thing. So these learning cycles, by their very nature, learn from variation and breed further variation. In the process, every stakeholder or every decision maker will get advice about what at that point in time mm-hmm. seems to be, based on the data, the best thing for that person to do. But I think that's a best, I think that's an N equals one optimization very much yep. along the lines of what you were describing.
Okay. Rory, do you have an opinion?
Yeah, I agree, the N of one is how we have to go, but I think we're going to get there by having, so we have standardization in some ways today. Mm-hmm. So if you think about a search engine, right, it's kind of a standard interface for a search engine. There's some variability in that search engine interface, and there needs to be, but it becomes more and more customized as you use it. Your smartphone. It as you use it, it becomes, so you go to the store and you buy a smartphone. That's the same smart, you know, there's some small N number of smartphones that you can buy. But after you've used it for a year, all those smartphones are all N of one smartphones. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what we're going to see in our whole life, so in our communities and in our homes as well. So the builder may be building some standardized technologies, high HIPAA filters for people with hypoallergenic, RFID or other types of readers, beacon readers to allow you to come in and out of the door, different zones of heating and air conditioning, home security systems, all of these sort of things. But they will learn from the individual. They will become an N of one a system over time. Mm-hmm. And I think the same thing is true for, you can do that, you know, apply that same sort of concept to healthcare technology as well.
I would like, if you don't mind, to defer to Clayton. And Clayton was the architect. Well, the reason I'm calling on Clayton was the architect of a funding initiative NIDLR is currently funding. So it was on cloud computing. And on the whole idea of accessibility features being built into the cloud and so personalized, so regardless of where a person was, whatever device they went to, they would be able to download their personalization technologies. Would you talk, do you mind, Clayton, talking a little bit about that?
You've just been named an honorary member of the panel.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, and I think this fits very much with what Rory was saying, so it's kind of splitting the difference. It's creating economies of scale to allow support on a highly individualized basis. So some of you may know the system that's playing out internationally, developing pretty rapidly, GPII, Global Public Inclusive Infrastructure Initiative, and as Margaret said, the core notion, there are many facets to it, of course, but the core notion is that anyone, doesn't have to be a person with a disability, can specify how they would like information to be presented to them and how they would like to interact with it. This specification, as said, is held, as they say, in the cloud, of course, with perfect security and privacy. And then when you're at any compliant system, and in the full ambition, this would be very many systems, but you can imagine to begin with your browser, you authenticate, the specification is applied, and within the limits of the platform on which you're working, all those specifications, needs and preferences you specified would be applied. But imagine, for example, that you're on the airplane and there's a seat back computer. The full vision would mean that a person who's blind, for instance, could authenticate to that system and receive an appropriate sort of screen reader driven version of whatever experience other passengers had. Mutatis mutandis, you're deaf, you know, whatever it might be. But you know, in line with what Rory is saying, the notion there is that everybody's needs are different, but at the same time, we can aspire to have infrastructure that provides the most flexible support for all those individual needs.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I'd like to propose a change to Chuck's diagram, that the learning system has millions of small n equals one learning cycles that are somehow being aggregated in a way. And I think posing that as a computational problem will offer terrific challenges to our field.
That's a great way of putting it.
So I think I am now expected to do many things at once. The first is that I want to thank our panelists for their presentations and our discussion today.